it's a Java-only cache, you can use both. If it's not Java-only, maybe you've got a PHP app that also needs to run with the caches. PH cache doesn't work, so you need to go to the format cache. Maybe you want a local cache, because you've got a performance problem, not a distribution problem. Probably EH cache, but that may be just a hash map. Right? So these are the things. Essentially, if you answer the questions earlier in this fight, you will get enough information to be able to answer that question for yourself. And choosing a certain amount of saying, okay, this cache doesn't support this app feature, so it falls by the wayside. And when your list is empty, you're stuck. Where was I? Okay, so freshness. How stale is acceptable? That's interesting, because that depends very much on the data. My date of birth is not going to change. Well, maybe I can fake it, you know, depending where I want to go, but the actual date of birth can be cached for years and be perfectly fresh and right. However, my financial situation is different. You know, my bank account does this. So you want, if you want information on how much money you can get from me, from the ATM maybe, you want to have the right information right there. So financial information tends to require that the freshness is very short. Seconds sometimes. You know, you can't store that for a year. It doesn't matter what my bank account looked like a year ago. That only matters for my credit, not for my situation financially. Okay? I have a beautiful example where we were using a cache, and what we did was we had a database and a read slave, which is essentially a cache, yeah? So that's a read-only copy of the data. And we would create a new account in a database, and then the person would log in to the system using the read slave. Now, that data was a few seconds out of date, so what I would do at the register, press login, and I would get an access denied exception. Because the newly created account hadn't made it into the cache yet. So the data I was looking at was actually stale, because indeed, 1 second ago, that account didn't exist. So the freshness that we were using, which was a few seconds out of date, was bad for that situation. All right? So you need to consider, also, you know, nobody's going to miss one or two Twitter messages that disappears or aren't displayed in your timeline over time. So then, you can do much more aggressive caching. So the data, the way you use it, what people expect from the data, that determines freshness and status. And then there's this one. Do I purge all the data that's not fresh? Do I just drop it and forget about it? Or do I keep it around me in case the backup dies? Very tricky. Yeah, every Wednesday night between 8 and 9, I see weird things on the user interface, but in the morning when I try to reproduce it, it's gone. Well, that's the backup slot for that backend, so that we're serving all the data. Try explaining that to your manager. Okay. And this is a question I like to answer with the team. Does the system work with cold caching? If I switch all the caches off, or the problematic ones, does the system still work? You know, on Skype, I think they had an outage 2 years ago now, where they couldn't bring their system back up. And it was partly due to having things cached that were gone, because the system was restarting. And they couldn't get the information out of the backend system, because they were overloaded, because the normal caching was. Then you have to do tricks like, I don't know what, shield your system and only allow partial traffic through. Lots of things. This is a yes to no scale. Yeah, it'll kind of work. Woo, it'll work. So if your system works with no caching, why have a cache? Why have a complexity of a cache? But as you progress to know, you come to the, yeah, it'll work. No problem. You know, you go to node 20, but after that subsided, I think it's fine again. And then you get to the point primary cache, you should warm them up, if you will. Systems like Redis, for example, what they do is they store the internal cache state occasionally. So when the server crashes, it comes back, they read back the memory image, and they're behind, but they're not cold. So they're sort of lukewarm, if you will. Yeah, so that can help keep your system alive. You're already in the danger zone by that time. And some systems, you just can't switch up. Because the load is so high, your caches are so important, then you really need to think about what you're going to do. And you better figure out a solution before power goes down. All right. So, you've got the problem, defined. The server is true, you've got the evidence. Now what? How will we know that the cache actually helps? We're going to implement a solution that costs lots of time. How am I going to explain to my manager that that investment in time is something that doesn't add any features to the system, that it was worth it? How do I make the business case? Hey, I'm in the monitoring business, so my answer to this is monitoring. And monitoring caches, who here monitors caches? Yeah, I saw that. Nobody does that. You know, I've got like 400 caches in my system, and you just don't look at all of them. I just talked today to a guy, I don't know if he's in the room, yeah, he's in the back there, who's working, been looking at CPU caches, level 2, level 3 caches. He can monitor that. Now that's cool. Anyway, other guys. What you need to do is, when you implement the cache, especially the big ones that play an important role in your architecture, you need to extend your monitoring system that you all have to also include information on your cache. And that's really hard. One of the things for Java that I've been thinking about is saying, okay, what I want to offer my users is a generic way to be able to monitor all caches. And I haven't found one yet. The problem is this, look, this is the machine where the query cache is. It's MySQL query cache. MySQL query cache is an interesting cache, by the way. What they do, sorry for the digression, what they do is they take your SQL statement as it comes on the wire. They don't parse it. They use that string as a key into the cache, as a string. And then whatever they sent out last time, they'll send out again. Right. So that means that if you use select star from user with all caps, and you use select star from user with no caps, to the MySQL query cache, those are two completely different SQL statements. And it will be cached separately. Right? So here's a system that achieves 49% cache efficiency, 50%. I was actually well chuffed to see that. I was like, wow, 50%, I can't believe that. Because that is actually a mostly right system. It's all gathering statistics, and yet 50% of the queries I run against it is being cached. Even though MySQL query cache, when it flushes information, is pretty drastic. When I do an update anywhere on a table, all queries that go that are cached from that table are all flushed, all of them. Because, you know, as it is a binary cache, it doesn't know on a row level what queries, what part of the table it was caching. So 50%, I was really happy. And then we go here, which is sort of the same graph. You can see query efficiency, 99.31%, which is pretty bad. Even though 99.3% of the queries are being answered from the cache, not the database. This is a static WordPress site. We don't even have a counter that increments how many people looked at the page. There is no update. And yet, I don't see 100.00% cache efficiency. So where's the other 0.3%, 0.7% that's missing? Okay? Point I'm trying to make is, even if you look at things like cache efficiency, interpreting that number and saying this is good and this is bad is not something you can automate in a generic way. You have to have a human point, it's so small that the cash is no longer efficient. We're losing efficiency here. So when I set it back to 2 megabytes, then it became efficient again. And it's a completely way of looking at the very same cache. So when you sit down and design your monitoring system for your caches, you need to talk about what does this cache do? How are we, as a group, going to decide whether this is an effective cache? There's another one, I'll skip that. You know that. Oh, alright, so the monitoring you do is also next week's outlet. The monitoring is actually... maybe we have 10 minutes. The monitoring is the evidence I spoke of earlier. Yeah, so by now you will have a monitoring system. Otherwise you wouldn't make it this far. You would have stopped your project to implement caches. You wouldn't be doing a project implementing monitoring systems. But without them, it's very hard to decide what's going on. There's some generic things you can monitor. Think of the cache hits versus cache miss ratio. That is universal in the sense that most caches have something like that. You can monitor it. But then you need the human to set a trigger level on that, saying, okay, this is the level that we want to alert on, and this is the level we find acceptable. And that's different per cache. Cache fill level is another one. Some caches don't like to be full. Some caches you don't want to be full because they run out of RAM. So you need to keep an eye on how much is in there, how much stuff is in there. Am I caching the right stuff? Am I maybe caching too much? And then there are other things that are really, really specific, like fragmentation. If the cache is organized in blocks, how many blocks are being used for how many queries? Uptime. Did it crash? Did somebody switch it off without telling us? Useful metric. Purge rate, config rates. These are product specific. So when you sit down saying, okay, I do, as you say, I select between each cache and memory cache. After that, you sit down with the manual and you read about what defines a healthy, whatever it is you check, you decide to use cache. I spend quite a bit of time on MySQL cache because that, to me, is one of the most important caches in my system. So I know a lot about that. But that's because I invested the time to study it. And I know the product-specific things about it. Maybe half. There's always more to know. But the point is, sit down, learn about your product. It's not a drop-in. No, everybody will claim it is, but the product is never drop-in and it's never switch on and it works. It doesn't work like that. And then, I put the slide last. This is the last slide. Why? Because this is the question that comes up last. Like, oh yeah, so we've got this caching and we're in acceptance testing. And, oh, by the way, who's going to tell the system administrators that we're going to need a 6 machine memcache cluster? And sysadmins go, what? But no, we're phasing out machines, so we're actually having to reduce the number of machines. Yeah, I've had the discussion. Okay, so what about the cache? Well, we don't care about cache, we care about online. Who do you need to inform about this? And preferably a bit more early than I've done in this presentation. You want to talk to your developers. Everybody has to understand about the DevOps is that you see software development teams and operational teams, they start working closer together. They need each other's skill sets. They need people in the development team that actually understand databases and hardware to be able to write good performance applications and be able to scale them. They need developers on the operations side because no application is a black box anymore. You can't just install it and say it doesn't work. No, you have to sit down, you have to script it. You have to actually write code to be able to start, stop, and run applications. So that's why you see DevOps as sort of a mix between development and operations. And it's a broad term, you know, like what Joe is going. It's something to keep an eye on. And with that, I would like to close this presentation with the slide that I started with. Because this, at the end of the day, is the very, very most important. Thank you for your attention.
Five minutes and we will start the next session.